yet. That's not to say it won't.
We had an Irish lad, and he wanted to come to us. And in the days of my parents were wanting me where I was going to be happy, and parents got maybe a box of chocolates or some flowers off the clubs. But now the parents are saying, we've been lead supporters. We'd love our son to go there, but we've been offered this by your ex. And these are people who will never see this money in their life. And
well, what sort of money are you talking about? Are we talking a great deal of money?
I'll be diplomatically ahead of you, but very
yeah,
substantial.
Yeah, large sums of money. And you know, like we all know, there's no guarantee that if you guarantee that money later on, that player will be worth it and will become a player.
Right, so you're an agent. You go to the family, you give them 30, 40, 50,000 pounds. What can you do for that kid at 14? What can you do for him?
You can only get his head straight, because the coaching has to be left to the clubs. But
you're going to give him £50,000 to get his head straight?
No, I'm not saying we give £50,000. I'm saying that there are sums of money that are paid to kids anywhere between £1,000 and £50,000. The most likely sum of money to be paid to a family for signing a child is probably in the region of £10,000 to £20,000. I have known it be higher. For that sum of money, obviously of the family, you would expect the support of, or the ability to support that family and that child in his development. You have to leave the coaching to the clubs.
How come you're at Tottenham, at the Tottenham Academy, and this is all Arsenal?
I'm not forgetting that. Handball, my free kick. Do you know who's the best two midfielders in West Ham?
Who is it?
Michael Carrick and Joe Cole.
They're great, aren't they? Do you think they're going to play for England?
They should. David Beckham's rubbish.
David Beckham's rubbish? No, but what if an agent did come?
No.
What would you say?
I wouldn't answer the door.
No.
We're his agent.
Yeah,
we can guide him.
Yeah. As parents.
We can guide him as parents. I think I've got enough.
I'm sure when he comes to an age of 16, 17, 18, he'll have his own mind. Knowing John, he'll have his own mind.
Yeah.
Who's the one that you got at Wembley?
This is one. I don't need a box.
A lot of famous people have played in that pitch, you know, at Wembley. Cup finals, England matches. There's a lot of professional footballers who never played at Wembley, and you've played there already.
I'd love to have more crowds around me.
Oh, these are pictures.
Picture of what?
Wembley.
Right.
John is 8 now. I can't tell you whether he's going to make it, but I do know there are agents out there trying to sign kids as young as 10. I also know John loves playing football, and for now, that's all that matters.
We've never been this late before, Dad.
Nah, never been this late, but it's alright. Because Carl
himself. Do you like your dad taking you to training? Mm. So you're always giving him little pieces of advice?
I can't give him that advice, he's better than me. No, I do, honestly, yeah. But I remember him playing a Canby game once, I can't think it was again, so he took a corner and he tried to curl it in from a corner. And he looked at me and I went, no. And I was wrong, really, I shouldn't have said nothing. Because he looked at me with a bad look and didn't say, well, I tried. So, that was it. I don't say nothing at all now. Nothing.
He's off.
He's off, look, he's off.
Like thousands of other kids across the country, John attends two training sessions a week at one of the 19 Premiership academies. The boys must live no more than a 90-minute drive away. The search is on for local heroes. But these centres of excellence are not just about giving gifted kids a chance. Make your own star, and you don't have to buy somebody else's. Thank you. Michael Owen, Robbie Fowler, Steven Gerrard, all came through the Liverpool youth system. 3 years ago, the club spent £12 million on a footballing university for 150 boys. Talent spotting has become an elaborate science.
Football wasn't ready for that 10 years ago. Football was full of people who had finished playing the game one day and were coaches and managers the next. Are they the people that should be, you know, spending unlimited access time with 9, 10, 11, 12, 13-year-old youngsters? This place is full of specialists. Specialists in the development of young people, not just footballers.
You can't tell at any stage if a kid is going to be a great player.
Arsene Wenger said in an article last week, anybody who tells a young player is going to be a pro is either a cheat or a liar.
The aim is to try and keep the place pretty much the way it was when we built it. And that's the problem with kids today. They feel that the danger is that because they're in an academy on rung two, that 6 months they'll be on rung three, another year they'll be on rung, and it's an automatic progress up a ladder. Well, football doesn't work like that. So the last thing you do is ever tell them that you think they're going to make it, even if you do think they're going to make it. We work hard here to make sure that you don't tell them that. Mm.
Probably driven by the fear of not making it, because my mum and dad always sort of drummed it into me that you ain't made it yet, you know. They've never ever pushed me or anything. They've always treated me the same. I think some parents get in the habit of, like, you know, when you see them on the line shouting at their kids, you know,
yeah.
And they get them in the car and they run through the game on the way. My dad and mum and dad never did that.
Well, if you remember that for a Saturday night. Technique, attitude, balance, speed.
I'm glad you recognise any of those words, you know.
Unfamiliar ones to me.
I would say speed, you were pretty good on.
Balance.
Well, you're a very upright sort of player, weren't you? You were very dynamic with your balance. Attitude. Yeah. Well, technique. Well.
The boys have been used to hearing that the best thing since sliced bread probably since they were about 7 years old. I think there's a huge responsibility to be realistic. And I think you have to be brave enough to tell it the way it is. And as you can imagine, I'm not always very popular with parents.
The clubs are prospectors sifting gold, but they can never be sure they've found it. Precocious 8-year-olds may already have peaked by the time they are 12. Even one step away from a Premiership first team, players can sink without trace.
You see, the problem is there's so many talented youngsters, and then at the age of 13, 14, 15, the academies spew them out, and they're disillusioned, dejected, and some of them don't play football anymore.
Yeah, that's right.
Then it could be the other way, at 13, 14 and 15, he could decide he don't want to do it no more, hence girls, nightclubs, he might think, well, I don't want this, and then it'd be a relief that we haven't got to see him get disappointed. He could think, well, I don't want it anymore. Not that I can really see that, but whether he'll make a David Beckham or just, you know, an average professional that's, you know, I don't mind, long as he's...
The average professional.
Yeah,
enough,
yeah, that's right. I mean, I don't want him to be...
That's for sure.
We're not aiming him to be any great big star. We just want him to do what he wants to do in life.
Mm. I don't think any young kid when they're 13, 14, 15 says, oh, I want to be a footballer to be a millionaire. That never ever crossed anyone's mind. We were... You know, I've got this contract, I'm going to be a professional for 2 years. They've offered me 2 years YTS, 2 years pro, and then you ask your mate, and he's got 2 years and 1 year. I mean, me and Stevie Gerrard was the two that have, you know, been mates right the way through, and thankfully both made the first team. But none of it was too heavy, and it was mainly, you know, going down, having a bit of skills and maybe a match at the end, and it was really fun, I think.
Michael was guided by his father Terry, an ex-pro. Still only 21, he is now a £25 million asset to his club. But the book of fairy tales is a slim one.
judge. Yeah. A 15-year-old, I take away his life, and so should you take away.
Your boy did go to the academy, didn't
you? Yeah, if you have an opportunity to play for a big club like Liverpool, Manchester United, and so on. It's a big chance here. You start seeing, okay, he's going to make it, and so on. But when I got in there, you know, I started seeing the negatives. You have to sign a contract, you know, that, okay, this kid's not going to play for the local sides anymore. He can't play for the school even.
But when he signed for the academy, it must have been a proud day for you two and for your son.
Well, exactly, I mean...
Yeah, but our son, he was more worried about what Howard, how you was going to feel at the time. He wasn't happy, really, when the scouts come to look at him, and that's the reason why they went to the school.
They should not approach the child, they should approach the manager of the football team they're playing with. I mean, I've had experience where my child has been collected from the football pitch and drove home by a scout. And I've
without your permission?
Yeah.
Well, what did you say to the scout?
I just said you had no right to do that.
And what did he say?
Well, I asked him, was it okay, so, and you brought him home. The child then is given time on its own that the scout is going down his ear. You know, you're not there to listen what's said. You're not there to guide the child. So therefore, his inspirations are going higher and higher in the car when he's driving or when he's listening or, you know, being fed with all kinds of stuff. But then you have to bring the child back down then to reality.
You see, I can't believe that was allowed to happen, that a scout can go to a park or whatever and pick up... What age was the child?
He was 13.
Pick up a 13-year-old and take him in the car?
Yeah.
That shouldn't be allowed to happen.
Only one thing the kid gains out of this is that, okay, look, you have a dream of becoming a professional player for that particular club. And we all know that the chances of that happening is quite slim. The clubs don't think about that at all. At the end of the day, all they're thinking is the bottom line, money. If that kid makes it, okay, that kid gets sold or maybe plays for the club, okay, and it's worth a lot of money. The kid is just a commodity.
Out in the talent jungle, not everyone plays by the book. And not every kid is lucky enough to end up in an academy.
It's classroom, excuse me a second, boys. The boys are on a break. John's under 18. 17,
sorry.
Chris is under 19.
So what positions do you play?
Centre midfield.
Centre midfield and?
Centre back.
Centre back. Hard position that, you know. Yeah. Right. Push up, hold a line. Yeah, how can you tell if it's working? The number of players that get into the Liverpool's first team?
That's how the club will tell you if it's working. That's how the club.
I thought you were part of the club.
Well, I am part of the club, but if you're a director and you're or you're Rick Perry or you're Gerard, perhaps that will be the only thing that matters, yeah. I'm involved in the education of youngsters, not just how good they are football-wise, because at the end of the day, it's an enormously difficult thing to, I don't like the word produce, to nurture a Premier League player who's going to play for Liverpool. Yeah. Our reserve team is full of internationals who can't get a game for Liverpool. The ultimate aim of producing that genius is enormously difficult, enormously difficult.
So what are you going to be doing next season?
Well, at the moment, I'm looking for another club at the moment. We're not getting renewed the contract, so me and Peter, we're in the same boat at the moment. Went to the exit trials last week, and we're just waiting to see if we get any clubs coming in for us now.
So what did it feel like when Stevie told you that you wouldn't be here next season?
I was gutted, because I love the place, and I want to play in the first team. I've always supported Liverpool. I think you've got to be realistic. It's a big club, and maybe it's just not the right time for us here at this moment.
How did you feel?
Obviously, I was disappointed, but in the back of my mind, I was thinking that I'm getting on to 20 now, and I need to be breaking into someone's first team, so if it weren't going to happen for me yet, I'm maybe going to be best in my own mind, looking elsewhere myself.
Were you surprised that Liverpool didn't keep you on, or did you know it was going to happen?
I think... we were surprised because I don't think anyone wants to admit to themselves that they're not going to be at a club next year. But I think realistically we had an idea.
Did you say anything to the two of them when you heard the news?
Just gutted for them, just said there's nothing you can do really, is there? Just hope you find a decent club and get onto another club, isn't it? So
what advice would you give to any 12-year-old kids that were coming here?
Just enjoy playing football and trust the coaches and let the coaches take care of the boys and don't get involved.
Get involved with agents.
Too many parents allow their own kids something and it's hard to get an idea behind the station, I think.
What about parents? Do parents interfere too much?
Yes. You know, there's good parents and bad parents, without a doubt. There's good parents who are there for to look after the kids for the best things, and there's other parents who they don't really understand the financial side of the things, and what they ask for is, you know, they're asking for what they read in the papers, really. Right. They're the ones that can be a problem.
A good parent will wait up.
Yeah.
They would have to sacrifice the money for the club or sacrifice the club for the money. Now, what do you do?
Hard, Alan.
Very
hard. Both decisions are the right ones, really, in many ways.
The only right decision is when the boy makes it.
Yeah. Do you choose to live here? You choose the place?
Well, my mum did. I said, like, I'd like to live near, close to the ground, and she just real come and had a look and like, found that it was, like, nice houses. And
yeah.
Like, a good price in it. And it's right close to the training ground. It's 5 minutes down the road. And Michael just lives up here.
So do you go and visit him occasionally, Michael Carrick?
Yeah, he's there with his flash motor and that, so...
Has he got a flash car?
He's got the old BM, yeah. He's looking around, he's looking at the new Mercs now. He won't tell me. I keep asking him, what car are you getting, Mike? He won't tell me, though. He's keeping it close to his chest, I think. He don't want none of the boys copying him, I think.
Is that what you two talk about? Cars, fast cars?
Fast cars, yeah.
So you go to a parent, right, and say, right, we'll give you 20 grand for your son to sign for us. Nobody in their right mind is going to turn it down.
No, they're going to take, you know, sure, if you offer it to them, but in most cases, they tend to ask for it. It's not a case of you offering it. It's like the old man wants a new car or something. You know, that's a problem nowadays, you know.
Well, that's a major problem if the parents start to interfere with
But they do interfere. They think every parent, they think, oh, my kid's going to be this, he's going to be that, we want this, we want that.
In my short time at Nottingham Forest, I had a situation with a player. I asked the people in charge of the youth side, a lad that we were looking to release at his end of his 2 years. So I said, what's the story with the lad? Is he good enough? They said, no. I said, what are we going to do? They said, keep him. I said, what are you talking about? Got to keep him because his brother's 14 years old and his dad's been in and said, unless you keep him, my other son's going elsewhere. So as a manager, I'm sat there thinking, as a person, I'm thinking, that's not right. It's not right for the kid because you're keeping him and he's not good enough. He won't play. But ethically, it's not right either. But it does go on.
Never been so tired in the house. It's near the cameras are coming round. Normal teenager's room. Don't think there's anything sinister in there.
Bought
that platinum disc at the shop for Oasis. Cost me a few quid. There he is, look. Nicky. He loves the camera, look. You got rinsed today, Nick.
Did you get thrashed?
Come here and tell Alan how good a player you are.
You scored any goals?
Five.
That's more than Joe's got, isn't it?
Yeah. That much
Joe's got in his
whole career.
I said to my mum and dad, like, there's loads of clubs and they was all offering me good contracts and I was like 13, 14 and they're offering me like contracts till I'm 21 and with like, well, a lot of money. At the time I was thinking of it, bloody hell, now I'm rich here. You know? But I said to my mum and dad, they said, just choose what club you want to go to and where you're happiest. I think that's what all parents should do with their kids, not chase the money, not say you got to go there because they're offering you a few quid more than the others. Just go where you're happy and if you're good enough, you'll make it, I think.
But that's very difficult if you haven't got money.
I know, but that's what I've said, that's why I owe a lot to my mum and dad. If my mum and dad would have said to me, look, we're struggling for money, which we weren't, would you sign for this club? I would have done it, obviously. But went to West Ham because I had all my mates there and just a good club.
What if Joe Cole, at 14, his father said to you, Harry, somebody else is offering me 50 grand for Joe to sign?
When Joe was 14, you want the truth, if his dad walked in his office, Alan, and said to me, I want 30 grand for that kid to come to West Ham, I'm telling you now, I'd give it to him.
Talent is a blessing, but it's also a commodity. Talent brings the real world crashing in.
At the end of the rainbow is a 6 grand winner.
bonuses, really, because, I mean, if you're on whatever you're on, 30, 40 grand,
say 20, 30, 40 grand a week, you might have bonuses. And that is a problem within the game, because people can go and make a great 11, and it doesn't matter. And right. I'm not saying everybody's like that, but you'll get certain people like that.
It's funny because I used to go home and I used to see him on his BMX.
his BMX.
Revving up, yeah. Yeah, he was very much enjoying his childhood and no pressures at all. He was just a normal kid in them days, really.
At what stage did you realise that you'd won the lottery?
Never.
Never at all?
No, I mean, it's a great feeling when I see him leading out England and all that kind of stuff, you know, because when I started, I had no idea how good he was going to be.
When you're 10, 11 and 12, you don't need advice. You just need to go and enjoy yourself and go and play.
Yeah.
But now, what we've got is we've got agents crawling all over.
Yeah.
Good young kids at that age.
Yeah.
There's got to be something wrong with that.
Yeah, there definitely is a problem there. But when kids get to 14, then they need some advice because...
At 14?
No, because they're signing scholarship forms and schoolboy forms. They don't need a lot of advice. You know, they just need someone to say, oh, you know, do this or do that. That's it.
I tell you now, lads, if people can't take bollockings out here, they shouldn't be playing football.
How many agents came for you, Saul, when you came to the fore?
one or two.
One or two?
Yeah, that was about it.
And what did you say to them?
I didn't want one. That's what was that. Didn't want one. That was that. It was,
why? Because you thought you didn't need one?
Didn't need one at that particular time. And I was happy to be by myself and enjoying football and not. I didn't need hassle. Just didn't need no hassle.
What parents should be thinking is, why is this person coming to me and saying, we'll give you this and we'll give me that? And my kid hasn't done anything yet. If you're young and you're impressionable, your parents are impressionable and you're impressionable, and you get the wrong advice at an early age, then that sets the trend. If you tell a kid, look, don't worry about that, just concentrate on your football, say to the parents, it will come to him when he's 19, 20. Some parents have been told that it's going to come to him when he's 14 or 15. So if you told them, wait until he's 20, 21, they're not going to want to hear that.
Right, if you think we've got the divine right to go out and win this league because we're top of the league and we should just turn up and beat these people, we've got another thing coming.
England's under-17 set off to play France, the world champions at senior level. Fame is within their grasp and many will be Premiership players within 5 years, but they're not there yet.
Is it difficult dealing with attitudes when the kids at under 17 are multi-million pound players?
That's a big factor in our plan. To a certain extent, it's easier from our point of view to manage them because we're not trying to get them on contracts. We're not negotiating wages with agents and so on and so forth.
Well, your life's a doddle then, isn't it?
Our life's a doddle compared to that. No, we have to manage the baggage that they might bring with them. And obviously, by getting them young, by getting them at 14 years of age, trying to instill a few principles, hopefully we can develop an attitude, a mentality that says, I've got an opportunity now, and it's only me that can throw that away.
Plenty
of talking, and just make sure your concentration's up. You get away with things sometimes with your pace. Try and anticipate a few things.
Yeah?
Use your stuff to make it. You get the opportunity, one-on-one, to take them on. Everybody okay? Now, not that I want to put any added pressure on you, but I keep telling you that some of you are going to be in our team in 2006 when we win the World Cup. So I'll introduce you to Tord Grip. Sven-Goran Eriksson's assistant, who's already joined us. So I don't know if you want to say anything to him.
Wish you all the best, and less said, no pressure. No pressure at all. We want to see you in the Cup Final 2006 in Germany.
All right, so let's get in the middle, boys. Get changed, let's get ready, and then let's go back.
Oh, boys!
Arsenal's Jermaine Pennant is one of England's hottest talents. He was a multi-million pound transfer target before he was old enough to drive.
But the transfer fee from Notts County to Arsenal was unbelievable for a 15, 16 year old, wasn't it? Yeah. £2 million, was that?
That's what they say. I really don't know to this day the exact amount.
But did you ever think about that sort of money?
At the beginning I thought, because I saw it in the papers, I thought it's quite a lot, but I didn't really let it hit me. I was really concentrating on my football and trying to work on it.
Was it difficult for you? Was it a difficult passage?
I did have a bit of trouble from when I was at Notts County, like, because my attitude wasn't the best, because I come from a rough background, but I had people, and people at Notts County did help a lot. They took me out of my area, which is in Nottingham, and it was close to Notts County, but put me in the digs, and that quite helped a little bit.
And at any stage that you sit down and think to yourself, if I don't mend my ways here, I might miss out?
Yeah, at a stage I did. I thought I was going for a passion. I thought I need to buck up, because people are giving me back a lot of support, and it's like I'm just throwing it back in their face. So I did buck up.
How difficult is for a kid now at 17 years of age earning £10,000-£15,000 a week? He's got a flash car, he thinks he's made it. Where do you get the hunger and desire then?
Well, obviously, you know, you've got to kind of be strong, and the family's got to be strong around them to kind of don't let that situation taint their way of thinking. So, and you know, there's going to be times when, yeah, if that money is offered, some kids will go by the wayside, and some families will go by the wayside, and it might cause problems, and then everything starts going pear-shaped.
Yeah. I mean, that happened with young Jermaine Pennant when I first started representing him at 15. You know, the money element came in, and it caused him a few problems. But now he's okay. He's settled down, and he's just concentrating on his football.
If you've got too much money at too young an age, then the hunger goes.
You think so?
Without a shadow of a doubt.
I mean, when you were 18, what did you think about? Did you think about getting a flash car to go out and show off to the guests?
I used to get the bus.
Yeah, well, that those.
That made me hungry.
Yeah, that's right. But if someone's telling you early on that you're a success if you earn so much money, then maybe you're focusing on that a bit. What kids need is someone in them every day telling them that you've got to be as good as you can possibly be, whether that's playing for a third division team or whether that's captain in England at the World Cup.
I'm going to make some changes, but before I do, just we'll see how Jermaine is. How are you feeling, Jim? You're going to give it a go? Now, don't need to be a hero. We don't need to take chances, so if you just keep us informed about how you're feeling, all right?
On this site, near Burton-on-Trent, the FA have set themselves a target. They want to emulate the French Academy within 3 years. England, who have won nothing since 1966, need to catch up.
If you protect them and nurture them and develop their skills, you know, it will improve them in the long run. And quite importantly, are quite balanced individuals.
It's going to cost quite a bit, isn't it? What happened? Did you just say, right, I'm going to write a cheque for £40 million? Not quite as simple as that.
not quite as simple as that. I mean, it is going to cost a lot of money, but, you know, if you go back to 1998, the FA were making a profit of around £3 million. Next year, because of all the things that we've been able to do, we'll make a profit of probably around about £125 million. Now, the truth is, at that point, I'm in the very lucky position, and the FA are in the lucky position of finally actually having the funds to develop the game of football in England.
But the problem for some young kids and their parents is that they've been offered quite a bit of money that's tearing families apart. Are the FA aware of this?
I think from what I understand there's a lot less than there used to be. I mean, you probably know more about it from when you were around and a kid, if you can think back that long. You know, I think now, because the clubs can start working with kids so early, and because there's a rule in the academies, you can only take on boys that live within 90 minutes of the club, there's plenty of opportunities for every club to get access to good boys in their areas. So I think some of the problems have gone away. That doesn't mean it's non-existent, and I'm sure there is stuff there. And I think what we're trying to do is be a lot more vigilant about that and make sure that at all costs the boys are protected. It's also, to be honest, why a big part of the academies is also about education, because you want the boys to come out as rounded individuals who can actually cope with what football is going to throw at them in, you know, in later years.
Becoming a household name at 19 is something you can't fully prepare any youngster for. Joe's already a West Ham regular, he's in the England squad, but there's still a long way to go.
And this is the goal. I was at this game when against Scotland, Alan. The old sweaty's got turned over. Game. Yeah.
So the modern day players, English players, he's your favourite.
Yeah, Gascoigne, brilliant. Like, I got his shirt in there. Like, he gave us it because I sorted five bellies out of a ticket for Sunderland for his mate. So he dropped us a little shirt down with a little message, and that he said he's going to kick me all over the park, and I won't get near him next time he plays.
Mum! Yeah? Where's them shirts?
Zidane.
There's a little message in French, I don't know what it is. It probably sounds, stop driving me mad, asking for a shirt all the time. Par ami de ma vie. I wish I'd learnt French in school, man.
I'll try if I can, you know, I'll make sure I won't go off the rails or go, you know, drinking every night and doing all the sorts of things that obviously I'd like to do, you know, being a young lad. I'd like to be out with my mates all the time, but I just understand I can't do that if I want to be the best, and that's what strives me on.
All for one, and one for all.
There were times when you had to do a bit of no-nonsense defending.
Some of these lads may yet end up as journeymen in the lower leagues, and some will reap the harvest from 10 years of hard work.
That's the step we're making into being a great team.
Football's Dream Factory has never churned out such fame and wealth. As the best boys rise ever higher, the rest have that much further to fall.
It's not all you're going to be a player.
No.
You're tremendous, you're great.
Yeah, I don't think you can afford to go down that line.
And all I can hope is that when they walk away,